Hier achter mij ligt Silicon Valley, midden in de staat Californië in de Verenigde Staten. En als autoliefhebber ben ik hier een beetje met dubbele gevoelens. Want als er één plek is in de wereld waar je nog ongegeneerd kunt genieten van auto's met 6-cilinder en 8-cilinder verbrandingsmotoren, dan is het wel hier. Behalve als het aan de bedrijven hier in deze vallei ligt, want die zijn hard bezig om de toekomst van deze auto's drastisch te veranderen. En dat maakt mij als journalist juist weer extra geïnteresseerd, want er vallen heel veel verhalen te halen. En daarom duiken we de komende tijd in Silicon Valley. Waar ligt de toekomst van de auto? Voor deze aflevering gaan we opnieuw naar het stadje Sunnyvale. Op een steenworp afstand van Mercedes-Benz vind je daar het Nissan Research Center, waar het Japanse bedrijf werkt aan de toekomst van autonoom rijden onder de leiding van Nederlander Maarten Sierhuis. Tijdens ons bezoek was onze landgenoot op vakantie, maar zijn rechterhand Liam Petersen legt haar van uit waar Nissan precies mee bezig is.
Our goal specifically is to build automated vehicles, autonomous vehicles, mm-hmm. which could be with the driver inside, or they could be driverless, and to make them work inside an urban environment. So that's the city environment with other cars, pedestrians, cyclists, and you can imagine that's very different from the freeway environment where everyone is driving more or less in the same way. In the city environment, you've got those very complex interactions, and it's right. a much harder problem. I'd say it's one of the grand challenges of our times to solve that. If we really want to realize the benefits of this, you know, we need a solution that's completely reliable. I mean, a human being is, you know, we can drive about 100,000 miles before an accident.
Right.
And we expect our autonomous vehicles to have to meet that. That's a very high standard. And they've got to be much better than that. But it's not just about accidents. In fact, you know, the autonomous vehicles will be safe. Machines can be more reactive than human beings. They can stop. The real question is that will we accept them in our society? Because will they drive in a way that other human beings find socially acceptable? Mm-hmm. And imagine if we've got a fleet of hundreds of thousands or a million vehicles in the marketplace. Mm-hmm. If even a tiny fraction of them get stuck in ways like this because they're taking too long, or right. they can't figure out how to get past a construction site, or any one of these many situations that require human judgment, you're going to have the stranded fleet. In fact, you're going to have, you're no longer solving a problem, you are now actually causing a problem.
Right.
So that's why we need a perfect system, and that's what makes this an incredibly difficult challenge.
Zo'n perfect systeem moet dus kunnen omgaan met de meest ingewikkelde situaties in het verkeer. Bijvoorbeeld bij ongelukken of wegwerkzaamheden die niet standaard in navigatiekaarten kunnen worden meegenomen. Naast de vraag of we het moeten willen, is Nissan van mening dat zelfs de slimste autonome systemen niet feilloos kunnen functioneren zonder de hulp van mensen.
That is exactly it. We will never have... You know, we don't want to solve everything without human intervention because, that's it, it's these situations require human judgment yeah. because we are dealing with other humans. And only humans are the best people or the best systems for understanding other humans. And the question is, do you want a machine to make that judgment? I mean, irrespective of whether a machine can do that, mm-hmm. is it actually correct for a machine to do that?
Om een antwoord te vinden op die vragen maakt Nissan gebruik van de expertise die Sierhuis en Petersen hebben opgedaan toen ze bij ruimtevaartorganisatie NASA werkten. Daar ontwikkelden de twee knappe koppen een systeem om de Mars Rover op afstand te kunnen helpen vanuit het NASA-controlecentrum op aarde.
You cannot afford for that thing to fail out there.
Right.
But there is so much, you know, space is such an unforgiving environment. There is so much that can go wrong. Mm-hmm. And so what they have learned at NASA is how to, you know, the appropriate mix of having the vehicle on Mars take care of very basic safety, like right. not hitting objects. And then you have a back room full of, you have a team full of people on Earth who communicated, you know, through a very slow link actually only a couple times per day with long light-speed delays.
Yeah.
It takes up to 40 minutes just for a signal to get to Mars.
Right.
They construct very detailed plans about what it should do.
They make a new route.
They make a route. They actually will select, well, we want to look at that rock, and that rock,
right,
and that rock. And because time on the rover is very precious, they've built a lot of expertise on how to do that efficiently.
Right.
So how to understand, what we call become situationally aware. So how to quickly understand the environment around the rover,
mm-hmm,
so that they can make the right choices.
Onder de noemer Seamless Autonomous Mobility, ofwel SAM, gebruikt Nissan op dit moment een aangepaste versie van het NASA-systeem om autonome auto's te helpen in lastige verkeerssituaties. Vanuit de controlekamer in Sunnyvale kan een zogenoemde Mobility Manager ingrijpen zodra dat nodig is. Bijvoorbeeld bij een van de zelfrijdende Leafs die Nissan aanduidt met de codenaam Charlie.
Charlie, please engage. So now the car had set the goal. You're supposed to go through this route.
Yeah.
And then we'll see what happens. So the car is now driving autonomously. You see there's no issue. The car is blue. So the mobility manager is like just observing.
Yeah. Even voor de duidelijkheid, er rijdt hier dus nu een paar tiental kilometer verderop een autonome Nissan Leaf en die is verbonden met het hele systeem via de cloud en op deze manier wordt die auto dus gemonitord.
So now she clicks on the ticket, we call it ticket.
Mm-hmm.
Now she has the complete tools to assess the situation and become situationally aware that what is going on around here. And now it is time to now draw the solution. Given, let's assume that there is a construction.
There is a construction zone there. Yeah.
Yeah. You see, there is another car approaching. That's
okay.
The car.
Yep.
And she can has the ability to zoom in on the pictures. So if she wants to see what there is a sign, someone is holding a sign.
Mm-hmm.
What is written on that sign? She has the capability of zooming in, and get the detailed information. And now, assuming that there is a construction zone here, she created another path,
right,
which is going through the opposite lane, which is the car doesn't do normally.
Mm-hmm.
And now the solution would be sent to the cloud. Now it's available to other cars, and you see now this area became red. Once you have that information, then the rest of the other cars can use that solution and that information to drive through that area.
In de toekomst heeft Nissan dus talloze mobility managers in dienst die stuk voor stuk een aantal auto's in de gaten houden en zo helpen om zelfrijdende Nissans veilig en vlot op de weg te houden. Volgens Liam Peterson en zijn team is dit voorlopig de enige manier om autonoom rijden echt te laten slagen. En het systeem is al bijna klaar voor serieproductie.
I would say it's largely ready. So without this teleoperation system, it is not ready.
Okay.
That is really clear. We do not have, not just us, but the technology isn't available to do it to the level of reliability that we need.
But when will it be?
Without this system, I think it would be decades before it would be ready, or even longer than that.
Okay.
With the system, we can actually now roll it out. So, and I think we also need to distinguish between the market for individual users, who would be far more sensitive to the price point of this technology,
mm-hmm,
and corporate or service providers who can afford much more expensive technology. So the hard problem we have right now, one of the hard problems with autonomous vehicles, is the cost.
Right.
They're very expensive sensors that are needed and expensive computation at a price point that is still not yet available, that the individual consumer is unlikely to find appealing.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas for a delivery service or for a corporate customer,
mm-hmm,
where it is feasible to, because of the car, the higher utilization rate of the car,
right,
it is feasible to use more expensive sensors and more expensive systems. And therefore,
then you
to
mean
make
like
a system,
FedEx and TNT
for example,
in our country?
Right.
Yeah.
For example, and then you can make the case that there is a much stronger case to be made for greatly reducing the role of the driver because of that cost, And that's also then where this system comes into play. Mm-hmm. It's being able to helping us, you know, achieve the level of performance that's required if we cannot rely on an inside driver.
Een soort callcenter om te voorkomen dat autonome auto's zichzelf vastrijden in het verkeer. Het klinkt misschien als een tussenoplossing, maar volgens Nissan is dit de enige weg naar een veilige toekomst.
I think cars will become increasingly autonomous and increasingly automated. And we may even get to a situation where the cars can all speak to each other, mm-hmm. but the pedestrians are never going to be automated.
Right.
And in Holland, the bicyclists will not be automated either. So it's always going to be a system working within our society amongst people, regardless of the level of automation of cars.